about what kinds of questions you're going to give while you're out there in the garden centers. So, Rachel is passing out some handouts that are things that are not in the reference notebooks, and if you would like to three-hole punch them, to put them in your notebook. I did bring a three-hole punch, which is back there on that table, and at the end of the day, you're welcome to do that. I thought about how do you start? I mean, getting the right plan and the right size is just so critical for success in landscaping or landscape gardening. But one of the hot issues this year, of course, is the invasive plants, because as of January 1st, this past, garden centers and nurseries are no longer allowed to sell three of the plants that have been some of our most popular landscape plants in the past. So I thought I'd start out just by running through the presentation I had on some alternatives to invasive landscape plants, because I'm sure that people are going to be coming into the garden center and say, I'd like to buy a burning bush, or I want a crimson king Norway maple for my front yard, and you're going to be in the position of, you know, sorry you can't have that, but here are some alternatives. Of course, choosing the proper alternative depends on figuring out why the people wanted those plants in the first place. You know, what are those characteristics that made those plants desirable to them? And what are the site characteristics that are going to determine what alternatives are suitable to put into their yard? Rachel, do we have a clicker remote for this, or are we just pushing? Okay. All right, that's fine. My mouse thing. So first of all, I think it's really important that we don't use that word invasive plants too loosely now, because it does have a regulatory definition in the state of New Hampshire, and I'll show you briefly what the criteria are for a plant to be on the prohibited invasive species list. First of all, a native plant can't be an invasive plant in New Hampshire. If it's native, by definition, it can't be prohibited as an invasive plant, no matter how much it wants to spread, how weedy it is, how undesirable it is. If it's native, it doesn't qualify. Then you say, well, what is native? How long does it have to be here, and so forth? So if it's naturalized in New Hampshire, even if it wasn't here maybe 500 years ago, but it was here a couple hundred years ago, and it has naturalized in our habitat, then it could be considered. By the way, there is a fact sheet, and it is in the reference notebooks that the garden centers have or are getting, and it is on the web that covers all this, and it's called Alternatives to Invasive Landscape Plants. So you don't have to write all this down, and why I didn't give you a handout for this particular part. Okay, an invasive plant has some potential to really spread itself far and wide. It usually propagates prolifically by seed, and some invasive plants also are able to propagate themselves vegetatively by runners, underground stems, bulbs, rhizomes, whatever. Okay, but most of them do propagate by seed, and those seeds are dispersed either wind or by birds or other animals, so that the plant is able to move from place to place. In other words, if you can only propagate by running underground, how far you can move in a year is fairly limited. But if you can spread by seed, a bird can carry you several miles and drop the seed, and it can establish itself in a natural habitat or a pretty undisturbed habitat, and this is where we're most concerned with invasive plants. Okay. And if a plant does get into a natural or minimally managed habitat, is it able to displace native species, or does it cause some other disruption to that habitat in terms of out-competing native plants that are maybe important food sources or habitat for animals and so forth. And there's a whole, you know, ecology out there that can be disrupted by native plants such as, say, Japanese barberry, which can form very thick thickets even in the shade of the woods and displace, out-compete the plants that otherwise would be there. And so that's the criteria for invasive plants in New Hampshire. And every time there is a state committee that's appointed by the Commissioner of Agriculture, and it is their job to every year update the list of prohibited invasive species. If somebody proposes a species to be on that list, they are going to take it through the set of criteria and make sure that it is invasive that meets all those criteria before they prohibit it in the state. And they also go to the literature, the scientific studies that have been done anywhere in zones 3 through 6, because those are the zones represented in our state. It may have been in New Jersey or Michigan or something, but as long as it was in those climates, they're going to use that scientific evidence if, for example, they're not real familiar with a plant and it's become very invasive in Michigan, chances are it could also become very invasive here, even though it may not have arrived here yet. So this has been a controversial thing since 2001 when the legislature passed the Invasive Species Act, but it is now fully in effect. And there are some 30-some-odd plants that are prohibited from sale, distribution, cultivation, transportation in the state. Most of those are things that we don't want here, even if you think they're pretty. Things like loosestrife and Japanese knotweed and some really obnoxious weeds, and we're glad to have them on that list. The controversial ones were the ones that really people do enjoy as part of their landscapes: burning bush, Norway maple, and Japanese barberry, and to a much lesser extent, the water flag iris, which is the iris pseudocorus, the yellow one that grows along water, the honeysuckles, and multiflora rose, which you probably all recognize as invasive anyway. I worked for 2 to 3 years with nurseries, landscapers, the plant industry groups to try to come together on how to address this situation where the state is. And the state was gracious enough to allow the nurseries those 3 years to phase out those plants. Now, if you have a burning bush or a Norway maple in your yard, you're not required to get rid of it. Okay, this law says nothing about removing anything that's already out there. It just means you can't plant new ones, you can't buy new ones, you can't sell new ones, you can't put one in a truck and carry it from, you know, Key to Durham. Okay? Okay, so the nurseries and industry people and I came up with, you know, the need to identify some alternatives to these plants that they could then start to grow, propagate, get into stock in preparation for the time when those plants would not be allowed to be sold. And so I'm just going to briefly show you what some of those alternatives are. Burning bush, of course, is very, very popular because of its brilliant red fall color. I mean, that's why most people would want a burning bush, right? The other thing is they're really easy to grow and hard to kill. Well, that's exactly what makes them invasive, too. They have a, you know, you think about their size, they get up fairly large, 10 to 20 feet on the old ones, but they're a pretty compact mounded, you know, form, and so they are an attractive landscape plant. They're low maintenance, you really don't have any pest problems you have to deal with. They're stress tolerant, they're tolerant of a lot of soils, so that almost anywhere you plant one, it would do well, okay? Whether you plant one or a bird plants one, that's generally true. Okay, so what are some potential plants that might replace some of those characteristics? And there is no one plant that, you know, is, we could say every place there's a burning bush, put this one in instead. What we really need to do is think about the site. What are the site characteristics that will determine what does well there? And what is it that the person wants in a plant. And so if they're looking for a red fall color, the first five on this list will give them some really nice fall foliage. And I'm gonna show you pictures of these briefly. The bottom five are what I call our long list. The top five are what I call our short list. So there are places where some of these bottom ones will be desirable also, but the first five are probably the best in terms of fall color and have some other desirable characteristics as well. First one, American Cranberry Bush Viburnum, is not the same shape and form as Burning Bush for sure, but if you choose a certain variety, you will get good fall color, and probably one of the best varieties is called Alfredo. And that's also a fairly small, compact form of this type of plant. But you get a couple bonuses with this plant that you don't with Burning Bush, and that is you get the white flower clusters in June, followed by really nice fruit clusters that the birds enjoy, so it's got a wildlife value. The birds can spread these. They don't germinate and disrupt things and become invasive. They're much more contained than Burning Bush is. So these are some of the characteristics. This will want a well-drained soil. It's not going to do real well in a very wet soil. Full sun to partial shade is fine for this plant. One word of caution on the viburnums. We do have viburnum leaf beetle now in the state, and they will eat this plant as well. Blueberry. What better fall color could you get than high bush blueberry, especially certain cultivars that you may choose? Of course, what site characteristics would you need if you were looking to plant blueberries?
Acid soil.
Acid soil. So if somebody's got a pH of 7.0, you know, a blueberry is not going to do very well there. If they don't know their pH and they're interested in planting blueberries, certainly recommend that they at least do a pH test, because it will make so much difference, and it's so much easier to either choose a different plant or correct a pH problem before the fact rather than after the fact. This one you may not be as familiar with, called Red Vein Encheanthus. It's become one of my most favorite underutilized plants. A very unique growth form. As you can see, it's rather upright in its growth habit and has kind of a layered look. There's quite a bit of open space, and you can actually see bare twigs when you're looking at that plant. And so some people might think it looks, you know, not quite right. As it gets older, it does fill in quite a bit more, but certainly it does have a unique form.
Neal Harrigan, 9159, please.
Seed-grown plants will be variable in their fall color. I've seen them that are gold fall color. I've seen them brilliant red fall color. There are cultivars out there now that have been selected for fall color and also for flower color. See down here on the left, the flowers are very much like blueberry flowers, and this is in the same family and related to blueberries. Okay, so it's got those urn-shaped hanging clusters of flowers that are in the white to pink to red range in some cultivars. And then you do get a fruit. It's not edible for humans, but birds will eat it as well. Since it's related to blueberry, you may guess this is another one that's going to require an acidic soil. Does really well in part shade. That would be the place to put it. But we'll also tolerate full sun. Father Gila, there's two types. The shorter, more compact form is Father Gila gardenii, dwarf Father Gila, and the larger one is large Father Gila. Isn't that nice? They name them that way instead of the opposite. Really, really nice fall color, because even within the same leaf, you'll get a variation of shades from kind of a salmon color to red, all in the same leaf. So it's really, really a nice plant for that fall color. Plus, you get these gorgeous bottle brush large white flowers in the spring. And then in between, it just kind of fades away into the background. another plant that wants acid moist soils. It's kind of a woodland plant or a woodland edge plant. And I've put the hardiness zones on these, I'm sure you've noticed also. Another one, Aronia, underutilized plant, red chokeberry. There's also a black chokeberry, which is Aronia melanocarpa. This cultivar called Brilliantissima of the red chokeberry has been selected for that brilliant red fall color on the right. I've got these out in trial as well as the black ones, and they're doing quite well. The plant form is not great. It's at this point a kind of a small, medium-sized shrub. They will get up 10, 12 feet tall, so about that same size as the burning bush, but much less dense, so they are more open. But they also get nice berries on them that the birds enjoy when they run out of things they like. The red chokeberry obviously has red berries, and the black has blackberries. That's the main difference between them. And it is a native
Leslie Warren, 9372.
So that was some of the substitutes for red fall color for euonymus or burning bush. Here's a few for Japanese barberry, which most people like Japanese barberry because it's a very dense, low-mounding plant. And the most popular cultivars or varieties have been the purple leaf forms like Ruby Glow. And so primarily people may be looking for things with that purple leaf on them. Again, it's a pretty pest-free plant, low maintenance, does well just about anywhere that you were to put it. A little harder to identify some good alternatives for this one, but here's our long list, and I'll show you the pictures of the ones on the short list here, starting with some of the purple leaf wygelas that are now available. And there's been a lot of improvements in wygelas in the last few years, with not only the purple leaf forms, but also nice small compact forms that are available. So it actually could be a very good substitute, except of course it's deciduous, and so you're not going to have much there during the winter, but it will come back each year, probably as long as you're in zone 4 or warmer. Depending on the cultivar, maybe even zone 3, but I would say for the purple leafed ones, probably figure zone 4. Spirea, not very many of them have a purplish leaf on them, but you may get that same effect when it's in bloom by having a good flower cover on it. And spireas, of course, have always been very popular. And that kind of low-mounded, compact, dense form that you get with barberry, you could duplicate with spirea. Deutzia, especially the cultivar called Nikko, N-I-K-K-O, has that form. Doesn't that kind of look like the form that we're looking for here? And really, really pretty, nice white flowers in the spring. And for this cultivar, the fall burgundy colors. Not a brilliant red like euonymus, but more of a burgundy purplish color like the purple leaf barberries have. This one, probably zone 5-6. We're not going to go very far north in the state with this one until global warming progresses a little bit further. Common ninebark, kind of going from one extreme to the other. This plant can get quite large and unruly, but again, there are some improved cultivars out there. There's a couple purple leaf cultivars out there now. Listed at the bottom here, one's called Diablo and the other one's called Summer Wine. There's a couple chartreuse leaf cultivars out there right now. You also do get a flower show with these. And it's got winter interest because it has an exfoliating or appealing bark. So when it's lost its leaves, you still have something there that's of interest. And roses. Okay. Well, they've got thorns like Japanese barberry, so that's one similarity. And if you choose certain cultivars of roses, you may get that same size, shape, form as with barberry. But, you know, you've got beautiful flowers, which you don't get with barberry, so maybe that's a real bonus. The only one that's really a red leaf is Rosa glauca, red leaf rose. Most of the other ones, you're depending on the flower show for your color there. Of course, if you have problems with Japanese beetles, you probably don't want to add more roses to your landscapes. Instead of grafted, the question was, what does own root mean? As I had said, recommended to use own root roses. Instead of grafted hybrid roses, use the old-fashioned or shrub roses that are grown on their own root, either from seedling or cuttings. And they tend to be a lot more hardier and have a lot fewer problems than the grafted roses do. Not that the grafted ones don't have a place in the landscape, but certainly in a low maintenance situation, like you might have a barberry, you don't want a high maintenance plant like a grafted rose. Okay, Norway maple. This has been one of the most popular shade trees throughout the country. Because it is so tolerant of things like road salt, soil compaction, urban conditions, small soil volume, and so forth. And people particularly like the Crimson King, which is this purple-leafed cultivar. A lot of people will come up to you and say, I heard that red maple is banned in New Hampshire now. You go, no, red maple is not banned. This is what they're thinking about, okay? They hear that, you know, Norway maple is banned and it's, you know, this red leaf type, and they think that's a red maple. They don't realize that's a Norway maple. So be aware that there may be a little confusion there. So this one, again, is more difficult for alternatives. You have to think, one of the reasons people like Norway maple is for a large, fast-growing shade tree that has the red leaves. And so maybe the ones at the bottom are ones we're going to talk to them about. And otherwise, you know, they're a very popular street tree because of those tolerances to salt and other of those conditions. In that case, these ones at the top could be a better choice for those types of people. So this is actually a red maple, as opposed to Norway maple. That would be a choice for people. It's a nice shade tree. There are a lot of cultivars out there now. I would say just be aware that we have seen some problems with cold tolerance of certain ones in the past few years. When we get a really cold winter, like we had 2-3 years ago. And a lot of that cold damage happens at the graft union if they are grafted cultivars. So red maple is a seedling grown plant, or certain cultivars are fine and good and hardy and other ones are not. I don't have time right now to tell you, and I don't even have all the information collected to tell you, you know, this is good, 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 this is bad, bad, bad. But I'm just telling you that's what we're seeing out there, and we're trying to kind of digest this information and figure out which ones are good and which ones are bad. Red maple is a native plant. It's native to wet areas, swampy areas even, but it will also do well on drier upland sites. Northern red oak, another native tree for a large growing shade tree, for a lawn area, park, something like that would be fine. Some people hate it because of the acorns and having a mess or a nuisance, but if you like squirrels, you'll like northern red oak. The leaves, you know, are not what you want for a red fall color. You're going to get your brown shriveled up dry leaves, and they're going to hang there for a long time. Ginkgo, great, great tree, a little bit slow growing, so plan on being there for a long time if you're going to plant that one, but has a lot of the tolerances that Norway maple does as far as salt, soil conditions, etc., etc. You do want to use a male tree, not a female, because the female fruit has a very bad smell to it. And so obviously those have to be propagated vegetatively from male trees to know that they're selling male trees in the nursery. Otherwise, it may be 15, 20 years before they come into bloom and you would be able to tell if they're male or female flowers.
What's the lowest frost tolerance of the best?
Oh, it's very cold hardy. I think it's zone 3 or even 2.
Do the male trees have pods?
The male trees don't have pods, but they have a flower. But then after the flower, it just kind of drops off. Japanese tree lilac, Syringa reticulata, larger than your common lilac. It will get up. Arnold Arboretum has some that must be 50 feet tall. It can be a large shaped type of a tree. But if you want a blossom display, the flowers do look very much like common lilac, but they don't smell like it. They smell like privet instead. So if you like the smell of privet, you'd like this. If you don't, you wouldn't. But it will give you a show and a shade tree at the same time. And they also don't get the borers and some of the powdery mildews and things that our common lilac gets. I'm going to say probably 4. Okay. Yeah, it may depend on your microclimate, yeah. She's saying 3. I've never seen a book that said 3. But purple leaf trees, there aren't very many. Basically, you've got European beech, was a really the river's eye cultivar, which is a very, very large growing tree. So you basically need a park or a golf course to plant that one on. Or you've got some fairly small trees, i.e. flowering crab apple, certain cultivars, Purple Prince, Thundercloud, Pink Princess, and Pink Spires that have the purplish green leaves, if that's what you're looking for. Okay. And very important to choose disease-resistant varieties of crab apple because of our problems with scab and fire blight. And then we also could use flowering plum in the warmer parts of the state. Here's some varieties listed for the purple leaves, Azure Purple, Newport, Mount St. Helens, Thundercloud. Okay, these are going to, anything in that prunus family, basically, I tell people, consider it a short-term investment instead of a long-term investment. Enjoy it while it's young, healthy, vigorous. Eventually, it's going to succumb to black knot or some other disease or insect problem. Or cold. And sometimes, you know, cherries, plums, etc. will do fine for several years and then they'll just die and you never even know why they did. But don't think you're going to keep one of these for, you know, 30 or 50 years. Enjoy it while you can. So whether we're talking about alternatives to invasives or not even talking about that issue, when people are coming into the garden center and purchasing plants, your job's going to be to help them select the right plant for the right place. And that's become kind of a mantra. And everybody has heard that, you know, ad nauseum, but it says it all really in 4 words. And how do you help them do that? First of all, you're going to have to help them think about their site a little bit. They may not have thought anything about that. When they come into the garden center, you're going to have to ask them just a few questions to get some critical information on the site to help them make that choice. What kinds of questions do you think you should ask them about the site?
Sun.
Is it full sun, which means 6 hours or more of direct sun a day? Is it full shade, which means it never really gets direct sun? It may either get filtered light for a good part of the day, or it may get up to 2 hours of direct sun. We still consider that shade. I mean, we're talking basically summertime here, so 2 hours of sun, it would probably either be morning or evening, or maybe it only gets direct sun right at noon because there's trees on all sides. Partial shade.
901
basically anything between those extremes. So 2 to 6 hours of direct sun a day or good filtered light throughout the day. What else? Wind. Why is wind exposure important? Cold, okay.
Dry mouth.
Wind chill, but even more important is the desiccation factor. If you're talking about evergreen trees or broadleaf evergreens like rhododendrons, if you site those where they're going to be exposed to winter sun and wind, you're going to get that winter burn on them that's going to make them unattractive. Okay, so that's really important. What else do you want to know?
Soil.
Wet, dry, pH. Okay. Drainage. Really, 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 really an important question. Okay. Well, I don't know if my site has good drainage or not. How do I tell?
You have standing water after rain.
This time of year, is there water standing in certain places out there? After you get a good heavy thunderstorm, how long does it take the water to go away? Is it there for 2 days? It's not well drained. Okay, is it gone in 2 hours? It's probably well drained. If you really want to know, dig a hole, do a percolation test. Fill that hole, dig a hole a foot deep, fill it up with water, see how long it takes that water to drain through there. When we're not in a wet situation, you may not realize whether your soil is well drained or not, but you might have an idea of whether the soil tends to stay moist or tends to be very, very dry. You have to irrigate plants that are in this soil, you know, during the summer if we don't get rain for 2 weeks, or does the soil tend to be moist? And certainly pH. If you can only test one thing, pH is the thing to test, because it certainly will determine whether you choose something in that azalea, blueberry, and acanthus group of plants, or something, you know, up at the other end of the spectrum that can tolerate a high pH. So I think we've really hit on all those things except for soil or not. Okay, so you were jumping ahead of me here, but then, so once we know something about the site, we need to know what are some of the critical plant characteristics then, and somebody mentioned already, what is the size of that plant? Do they want a 50-foot shade tree? Do they want a 20-foot small flowering tree? Do they want shrubs? And why do they want those things? So I think this is probably when your customers come in, they're already going to have some idea about this. They may not have thought about their site, but they probably have thought about what they want out of a plant. So they may have some idea of what size of a plant they want, or at least whether they're looking for, you know, trees or shrubs or flowering plants. They may not know the difference between an annual and a perennial, and you may need to talk to them about that. They want some color, they want some flowers. Do they want to replace them every year, or do they looking for perennials that will come back every year, and so forth. Some people only want to use native plants. Yep, absolutely. Fragrance, flower show, you know, fruit, either for people, edible fruit, or for wildlife. People want to attract wildlife to their yard. There are certainly good ways to do that. On the other hand, maybe they don't want to attract wildlife to their yard. And I bet one of the most common questions you're going to get is, what can I plant that the deer won't eat? What about seasonal interest? If somebody's, you know, landscaping their home on Lake Winnipesaukee that they only use between June and September.
Maureen Falco, 9311, please.
They don't really care what, you know, winter interest it has. But if it's somebody that's a year-round resident that really enjoys a view from their window, or even, you know, a walk through their yard in the winter, maybe, you know, a tree that has beautiful cherry red exfoliating bark would really turn them on. And some people will care about shrubs that have flowers and look nice in the spring, and other people don't care if their shrubs have flowers or not. because they basically never go outside. They're just looking for something green to fill in, you know, an area. So the book that has been alluded to, and I'm going to provide these to for each of the notebooks. It won't be in the notebook because they're not three-hole punch, but you will have this as a reference. Yeah, Rachel, you want to pass those out? I think there's 15 copies added. We're going to do a little exercise with this here in a few minutes, so we're going to let you become familiar with how to use it. I think that's important. There's a lot of references out there, a lot of websites, but it can all be very confusing. The nice thing about this book is it's for New Hampshire. It's not going to recommend a book that, I mean, a plant that isn't suitable for New Hampshire, so you don't have to worry about that. You do need in it, we'll recommend.
June page 9311, please. June page 9311.
We chose not even to use cold hardening as zone numbers. We just say north, central, or south during as far as where it's suitable for in the state. So people don't even have to know what zone they're in. You just have to kind of know. So basically, north is going to be zone 3. Central is going to be zone 4, and south is going to be zone 5, or right on the seacoast, even zone 6. This book is organized into habitats.
Jerry Rickett, 9111.
So instead of just thinking about, you know, sun, shade, soil moisture, pH, all those things, if you can kind of place a plant in a general habitat. Is a plant that's going in an open sunny area, is a plant that's going into a flower border or a high maintenance type of an area, is a plant that's going along the edge of woodlands, okay, woodlands edge plants. And so they have to tolerate kind of shifting light conditions both throughout the day but also throughout the seasons. Is it actually a full shade area, a woodland area that they're trying to add some interest to? Water's edges or marshes have their own habitat. Obviously, soils could be quite wet there, but there are times of year when soils may be dry. You know, you get 10 feet offshore and the water level recedes and you get a drought, then maybe those plants need to tolerate dry soils as well as wet soils. There's also a habitat called rock gardens in here, so that's kind of specialized. And there's a section on container gardening, and Margaret will be talking about container gardening at the end of today also. The other reference that is not in print yet, but I have given you copies of the handouts of the plant lists from a new book that is at the printers as we speak, that we just completed the manuscript for, called Landscaping at the Water's Edge and Ecological Approach. And this is geared towards property owners, conservation commissions, planning and zoning committees, commercial landscapers, and so forth, that are landscaping along lakes, rivers, streams, estuaries, whatever, to protect water quality, making landscaping a part of the solution, not a part of the problem. And there is a two-day workshop coming up that there are brochures for back by my computer if you're interested in that as well. But the reason that I am giving you the plant list is just, again, as a reference material for you as you're trying to help people identify plants. This is a great plant list for people who are on waterfront property. It's much more extensive than what you would find in here under Water's Edge property. And if you look at that handout, it's fairly small, hard to read because I had to reduce it from a full book spread down to 8.5 by 11 page. But it's organized by ultimate height of the plant. So it's categorized by 3 to 6 foot, 6 to 9, et cetera, et cetera, and up over 45 feet. That's really important to most people on the water's edge because they want to view And so you don't want to recommend to them a plant that's going to get too tall and block their view if they're planting something. What we're encouraging people to do is plant as much vegetation, vegetative buffers along the shoreline as possible. That's nature's best filter. Okay? Have a small limited beach area if you want. Have a small lawn up near your house for recreation and play. But have as many layers of vegetation, everything from trees, shrubs, ground covers, to protect the water body from stuff getting into it as possible. And so if we're encouraging them to do that, and yet they want a nice view from the house to the water, you have to be careful not to, to plant something that's going to block their view. So, it's 1:30. We have a, well, 1:25. We have till 2:15. Here's the choice. We can go through this exercise. What I've done is actually make up three scenarios for you, and I would give you time to use these references here and talk with your neighbors and maybe come up with some solutions to that. And then we could go through real quickly the planting and mulching practices and probably not get to pruning. Or we could skip this exercise and keep going on PowerPoint. Okay, I'm going to ask for a show of hands because it's not fair that just the people I can hear get hurt. So if you would like to do the exercises, the scenarios, would you please raise your hand? Okay, not very many people. If you would like to see the rest of the PowerPoints, would you raise your hand? Okay, I was just wondering whether everybody was going to vote or nobody wanted to do anything. All right, well, we will. Let's kind of skip through this. Rachel, if you want, I will give you this. The scenarios, we could put them up on a website or something and have a little discussion about them that way. Any questions as I change presentations here? Please just shout them out. Mulching trees and shrubs. This actually is not in print yet, except for what I've given you, but it will replace the fact sheet that's probably in the notebook called Steps to Follow When Planting Trees and Shrubs. Okay. There's nothing wrong with the old one, but it's just kind of long and cumbersome, and this other one is a little bit more updated, and it's got a nice color, well, it was color, it's probably black and white on your copy, the last page. Looks like that. It's a nice diagram you can show people to, so they can picture, you know, proper planting depth, proper mulching practices, etc. That picture, by the way, is by Lauren Chase Rowell, who did all the drawings and illustrations for that last book that I showed you on the landscaping shoreline edges. Let's just briefly kind of go through some of the high points of this. If you can look at the handout called Planting and Mulching Trees and Shrubs. And I put it in a format where it's actually question answer. Well, these may be the questions that people are actually asking you. The first one is, you know, how do I buy a healthy plant? What do I look for? Okay. And I'm encouraging people to think about the roots, not just what the top of the plant looks like. Okay. Don't be afraid to tell people to pull container plants out of the container. If they're not well rooted in and they all fall apart, that plant shouldn't be for sale at that point. But more likely, the problem is going to be that those plants are going to be very, very root-bound, and that's not a desirable plant either. So ideally, the plant should be rooted in so that it's held together well in the container, but it shouldn't have a lot of matting or circling roots around it. The problem with that is those plants tend to never grow out of that. And so a lot of times a plant will survive for a couple of years and then it will die, and if somebody digs it up, they find that those roots are still just in that original configuration in the container.
Can you cut them away?
You can cut them. Even if you have a good quality plant, there may be a few fairly large roots that are circling, especially near the top. I would recommend that you take pruners and clip them so that they will then branch at the cut and will grow outwards. You can also slice the root balls of container plants. Take a X-Acto knife or a pocket knife and slice like four places down the outside of the container to cut a lot of those roots. And that will encourage the roots to branch. And roots, when they grow in their natural, unrestricted environment, will naturally grow out away from the plant unless they're restricted by something. So by cutting them, causing them to branch, when they come back and grow, they're going to grow out. Obviously, you don't want to completely destroy the root system because the plant has to live in the meantime while it grows out new roots. You need to help the customers realize that just throwing the plants in the back of their pickup truck and driving 50 miles without covering them is not a good idea. So make sure that they are aware that they should, you know, either put things in an enclosed vehicle or cover them with a tarp or plastic or something to get them home. They need to keep them well watered once they get them home if they're going to hold them before they plant them. Especially plants in containers, which are often in a soilless mix, will need to be watered every day in the heat of the summer. Okay. But primarily one of the biggest problems with plants is being planted too deeply. And we lose more plants due to being planted too deeply than you would ever think, especially trees. Okay, and so if you can help the customer just realize the proper planting depth by showing them this diagram, and I don't care whether it's a perennial or a shade tree, the top of the root ball, whether it's in a ball and burlap or a container, needs to be at the top of the soil level, and they should not be putting soil on top of that when they plant it. That's the proper depth, is at grade. Okay. That's why we don't recommend digging a deep hole. Dig the hole only as deep as the root ball is, so that the plant is setting on a firm surface and isn't going to soil sink when you water it, and then it will end up being planted too deeply. Instead of expending energy digging deep, dig wide, okay, loosening up the soil that the roots are going to grow out away from the plant is the best thing you can do for the plant, unless you're on a really well aerated sandy soil. And it won't make much difference, but especially if you're on a heavier soil. Loosen that up and dig the hole 2 to 3 times the diameter of whatever that root ball is on the tree that they're buying. Put it in the hole, obviously. Check the depth again. Adjust it if necessary. I would rather have a plant that's a little high than a little low. Okay, you can bring soil up to make sure they have good contact all the way around that root ball, and that plant will be fine. You can help them in terms of mulching. Tell them not to pile mulch up around the trunks of the trees or shrubs. Keep the mulch only 2 to 3 inches deep. Okay, in the area that they dug up for the hole, say, they want to put a 2 to 3 inch layer of some kind of bark mulch. Something or pine needles or leaves or whatever they have on top of that, not more than, we're saying now 2 to 3 inches deep because we used to say 3 to 4 and we ended up with 10 to 12. So we don't want more than 4 inches of mulch on top of the root zone, and we don't want it up against the trunk because it tends to keep that environment too moist. Okay, the bark of a tree has evolved to be exposed, not to be buried by either soil or mulch, which is going to keep it moist and make it more susceptible to things like borers, certain fungal pathogens that may be in there, and more attractive to rodents who may be burrowing around this time of year in that mulch layer. Water, 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 water. don't worry about amending the soil with peat moss, compost, soil-absorbing gels, roots, mycorrhizae, all these products that are out there to be sold. And I don't mind if you sell them, but the real key to good plant establishment is water. Okay? Research has shown that adding compost, peat moss, other organic amendments just to the hole that you dug to plant an individual plant in does not benefit that plant. And they have done many, many studies where they've amended these holes, not amended these holes, replicated, statistically analyzed, etc., and they have not been able to show a benefit unless you're in a really, really poor soil, which you shouldn't probably be planting in anyway. Because then you're going to have to dig out and replace a lot of soil to get a benefit. Question?
Yes. If you buy a tree that is grow out on a wire,
that is good in theory. In practice, it's very difficult to take all that off, then move the plant into the hole and not break up the root ball, which damages the roots that are there. So what I recommend is that they place the plant in the hole, get it, you know, stable in the hole, then remove the top half of the wire. I'll need heavy-duty wire clippers to do that. Remove the top half of the burlap, pull that back, cut it right there, and especially be sure to remove any straps, twine, ropes, plastic, whatever it is tying across the top of the root ball, because those things mostly are not biodegradable, and as the tree grows and the trunk enlarges in diameter, those things will girdle the growth of the trunk, and there are many trees, again, that we dig up 15, 20 years later and find those original straps, twine, rope, and so forth that's causing the death. No, because 75 to 90% of the roots are going to grow out of the top half of that. And so there will be so few roots growing out of the bottom of that that we're not going to worry about that.
That's even true for
taproot. Yep, because what they've done basically by harvesting that tree and balling and burlapping it, they've root pruned the taproot, and so the taproot is not going to grow down anymore. Mm-hmm. Yep. So just to finish up then with the water, for the what I've got in here is for the first few weeks. For the first week, say, water every day, okay, unless we're really into a rainy period. If they go out there, water every day. If they've built a little soil dam, soil ring around there and can fill that area up with water from a slow hose, that's fine. If they have a couple 5-gallon buckets and they can drill some holes around the bottoms, fill those up and set one on each side of the tree, that'll give it a good slow watering. They don't have to install drip irrigation. They should not depend on their lawn irrigation system to give that new tree enough water to get established. Okay. They shouldn't be watering their lawn that much that the tree will get enough water. Okay. After a week or so, they can cut back to, say, every 2 to 3 days on watering. After 2 to 3 weeks, they can go to a twice a week watering, of course, adjusting that for rainfall. As needed. But another very common cause of plant failure, especially in the first year, is not enough water or not frequent enough water. You have a plant, say that's, say it's a container grown plant, and you buy it in a container that's got that soilless media in it. You plant that in your native surrounding soil. The water actually is wicked out of that into the surrounding soil. So even though you might think, well, that plant did fine while it was in the container and it's got just as much water, that water is actually being drawn out because of the difference in soil texture at that interface into the surrounding soil. Well, until the roots can grow out there, the plant can't utilize that. And so that's why we need to water, especially container-grown plants, so frequently at first. It also takes a lot longer to get plants established than most people realize, especially when we're talking about trees. Now, if you're doing perennials, small shrubs and so forth, watering them as I've described for the first growing season, then after that they should be established and just go into your normal routine maintenance. But if you're dealing with a tree of any size at all, we figure it takes 1 year per caliper inch, which is the diameter measurement of the tree down towards the base. So if you're buying a 2-inch caliper tree, which means the trunk's about that thick at the base, it's going to take 2 full years before that tree has established its roots out into the surrounding soil and you start to see top growth occurring at a normal rate. Okay, so for those 2 years, you really need to make sure it's got enough water that you're not setting it back some. If you buy a 4-inch caliper tree, it's going to take 4 years, 4 growing seasons, before it really resumes its normal growth rate. So don't think that after 2 weeks you can just, you know, say, okay, it's good. Question?
To what degree should you be watering and consuming the first year?
After it's established, it should be able to go 2 weeks without water on its own, and that's kind of a definition of establishment that we use. Okay.
So that would be after the first year?
Well, it depends on the size of the plant. For shrubs, perennials, small trees, after the first year, it should be able to go 2 weeks without water.
Specifically, a large tree.
For a large tree, it may be, if you're talking about a 4-inch caliper tree, it will not be able to go those 2 weeks without water, probably for 4 growing seasons.
So what would you recommend for a watering schedule?
Well, I would say at least, you know, an inch a week, whether you do that in 2 applications or how you do that.
Depending on
rainfall. Adjusting for rainfall, yes. But rainfall really doesn't count unless you get a half inch or more during a rain event. Otherwise, most of it is evaporated. Right. And that's why we need to water frequently and well. You can't tell without digging down there, but I think I did put some guidelines on here as far as gallonage. Figure, you know, for a 2-inch caliper, put at least 5 gallons of water on when you water it. And so if you've got that water contained somehow, you know that 5 gallons is going to soak down through there pretty well. At that point, no, there's probably been a wetting agent put on in the nursery if it's in a container, and so that's probably still helping you some, but in a normal soil, a wetting agent shouldn't really be of any benefit. Some soils can be hydrophobic or repel water, but you shouldn't be letting it get that dry before you water. Excellent, excellent question and point. There is a lot of root growth that occurs during the fall until the ground freezes. Okay? Root growth, the optimal temperature for root growth in the soil is actually between 40 and 60 degrees or 70 degrees Fahrenheit. And so until your temperatures fall below 40, which we could say until the ground freezes, roots will continue to grow and they need that water during that time. Especially if you're doing late summer or fall planting, and especially if you planted an evergreen or a rhododendron, a broadleaf evergreen, you've got to get those roots grown as much as you can before winter, because that's when you're going to get that winter damage on those evergreens. And the more root growth you can get before that, the more resistant to that it's going to be. Yes? I would recommend that they allow for 6 weeks of root growth, which, so if you're figuring your soils normally are freezing around mid-November, you probably want to get it planted by October 1st. Okay, depending on where you are in your state, you can adjust that up or down. But if they're talking about get through the winter. Yes. Because they get that winter burn, because they have their leaves on them during the winter, they are still transpiring water, which means the water vapor is evaporating off their leaf surfaces. And yet, once the ground freezes, they're unable to pick up water through their root systems. So you get that brown, scorched appearance that we call winter burn. Whereas with a deciduous plant, since they've dropped their leaves, they don't have that water demand during the winter. Yeah, it's best to plant those in the spring if, you know, so you should try to sell most of your evergreens during the spring, early summer, but they can plant them up until about the first couple weeks of September and still get them established before winter. Especially if they've got the right plant for the right site, so it's in some shade and not exposed to that full winter sun and wind and so forth. Way in the back. And the question is, how do you let people know?
Yeah.
Well, you put it in the context of right plant, right place. Now, do you want to be spending your summers out there pruning and fighting back this plant to keep it below your windowsill, keep it from engulfing your house? Why don't you think about planting a plant that only matures to 3 to 4 foot for your foundation planting, and then tell them how much easier it will be to prune and maintain that than if they plant, you know, the yews by the front door and let them grow up, and soon you have this big of an opening for your front door, and eventually you have to use the side door. Yes?
Just to get back to the fall planting, if one found a wonderful value on magnolias or evergreens around the first of the middle of October, would you suggest that perhaps they could be brought into the ground in their pots and melt in the winter with less risk of damage?
If they're going to go into a shaded site, I would say you're probably just as well off to go ahead and plant them. Mm-hmm. It won't make much difference whether they're in their pot or out of their pot. But if they're going to be planting them in a more challenging site where maybe they're more subject to winter burn, keep them in the shade for the winter, either heal them in good with piles of mulch or drop them into the ground in their pots, like you're saying, and then plant them the following spring. If you have a reason to prune, a very good reason, especially on fairly young trees, is to train and get a good structure established so that later on in that tree's life, you don't have to come in and massacre it because it's grown into a terrible form. Another reason would be to correct defects that weren't taken care of early in the life of the plant. You can do some corrective pruning. Okay? The reason most people prune those is because they got the wrong plant for the wrong place, and they planted those yews next to their front door and haven't pruned them for 15 years, and now they want to cut them back so they can use their front door again. And this is where it's so critical to get people to use the right plants to start with. Some plants will just get old and kind of tired looking, and you can reinvigorate them or do some maintenance pruning on them to maintain their flower show and their nice look. And so those are the main reasons for pruning. Keep in mind that pruning is removing plant parts. We want to work with the plant's natural form, not against it. Not only does that mean choosing the right size plant, but choosing a plant with a form that you want. Don't try to take a forsythia, which is a naturally kind of fountain-shaped plant, and turn it into a meatball. It's not meant to be a meatball. And it's not good for the plant, and it's not good for my mental health to see those forsythia meatballs. Think about what you're doing when you remove the terminal part of a branch or a stem, is you're taking off the terminal bud, which makes a hormone that suppresses buds further down from growing. And that is the phenomenon called apical dominance. When I remove that bud, that hormone is no longer being produced in large enough quantities, and it allows those buds underneath it to break. So we've cut the stem or trunk or whatever on the left here. Next year it may look like this. It allowed a couple of those buds to break. After a couple of those break, then they're going to start producing that hormone and inhibit other ones from growing. So you're not necessarily going to get 20 buds breaking, but you'll get 2, 3, 5 breaking, and then those will start to become the dominant branches. Another basic thing you need to know a little bit about wood plant anatomy in terms of not injuring the plant when you do prune branches. Okay, this could either be a trunk with a, once we make a cut into that, it creates certain reactions in the plant. It will try to compartmentalize that wound, but that wound eventually is where decay is apt to get started. And of course, if that's in the main part of your trunk, then eventually it's a very weak spot and can cause failure in the tree. Another structure to look for is this raised bark between the branch and the trunk, or between the two branches that you're cutting. And that's called a branch bark ridge. Okay, that's also a visible clue that you want to cut to the outside of that, never cut into the branch bark ridge. So here's one where you can see the branch collar really well, and you're going to make your cut to the outside of that and not cut into this branch bark ridge. That's pretty easy. Here's one that's less distinct. The branch collar is less swollen, so you may not see exactly where that is. Then you're going to want to look for this branch bark ridge and cut a little bit to the outside of that and make your cut here. And you can be pretty sure at that point that you're not injuring the trunk tissue. Okay. Some trees, like maybe a red maple or something like that, won't have a very visible collar or ridge on it, but you will be able to find the branch bark ridge if you look carefully enough. If you actually find an attached or two branches here that are about co-equal in size, sometimes that branch bark ridge or that bark will actually be embedded. It will be growing down in instead of raising up like that. That's a very bad sign. Okay, and that means that that's not a good attachment between those two branches. And so pruning is a good thing to do, to cut one of those off. Otherwise, eventually, they're going to be growing against each other, and that's where a split is most apt to occur. So branch bark ridge is good if it's raised up. If it's embedded, pushed down in, it's bad. Or a sign that there's a bad connection there. Okay, so to make our proper pruning cuts, we want to cut outside of those branch bark ridge and outside of the branch collar. We don't, however, want to leave long stubs on, because that's then wood that's going to die fairly quickly because it's exposed. There's no leaves feeding it, photosynthates and so forth. And so decay actually will start here and work its way down in, and where the branch and trunk tissue becomes connected, that can also be a point where decay gets into your trunk. Okay. I'm going to just try to hit the highlights here, so I'm not going to go into this in detail, but these are types of cuts. Basically, a thinning cut means you're cutting a smaller branch back to a larger branch, okay, or a branch back to the trunk. A heading cut is just where you're chopping its head off. you're not paying any attention to it being, you're not really redirecting growth here. Whereas we can cut this up, the plant's actually going to put its energy into growing this branch. You're not going to get many buds breaking by making this cut, but if you just chop this off, you are going to get a bud right here breaking, and maybe one down here, and that's when you're going to get this witch's broom type of growth, which you don't want. And we'll just ignore this. This is for larger trees. Okay, one of the questions you're going to get is, when's the best time to prune my fill in the blank? Okay, if it's a woody plant, dormant season pruning is great. This time of year is great before they push out growth in the spring. It's great. So whether it's apple trees, crab apple trees, whatever woody plant, you're not going to injure the plant by pruning it during the dormant season this time of year. You're also not going to injure the plant by pruning in the summertime. Okay? There's nothing illegal or immoral about pruning in the summer. But you're going to have a different effect on the plant. You're actually probably going to stimulate more growth in response to pruning during the summer than you would by dormant pruning. So if you're pruning to control size and form, you may actually be stimulating more growth and then having to prune again if you do that in the summer, whereas if you do it this time of year, you won't have that effect. You can do light pruning anytime. You can do corrective pruning anytime. If you've got a dead disease or broken branch, please go ahead and prune that out no matter what season it is. Why you wouldn't want to prune, say, in another month or so, certain plants are called bleeders. Maples, birches, willows are common ones, and if you prune them right before growth starts in the spring, you'll get a lot of oozing and sap running. It doesn't hurt the plant, okay? But it makes a lot of people panic. So prune them earlier than that, or wait till summer if you have those bleeders and that's a concern. The other thing is, if you have flowering shrubs or trees, you need to know whether the flowers are formed on new wood or old wood. If the flowers form last summer before the plant went dormant, if so, if you do your pruning now during the winter, you're going to be cutting off all those flower buds, and the plant's not going to form them again until next August. If they're blessed to flower on new wood, that means that as the plant pushes out vegetative growth this spring, then they'll form their flower buds, and you can prune during the dormant season and not affect that process. Can anybody think of an example of a plant that forms its flower buds late in the season, and so you would not want to do dormant pruning?
Rhododendrons.
Hydrangeas. Azaleas, rhododendrons, hydrangeas, blueberries.
Hibiscus.
Yeah, there's too many hibiscuses to to think about. I would have to look up a specific one. So most of your fruit trees have formed their buds. So crab apples, pears, etc. have formed buds, you know, in the fall, so you don't want to dormant. I mean, you can dormant prune them, and they do commercially, but one of the things they're trying to achieve is a lighter fruit load, so the fruit they do have gets bigger instead of having zillions of little fruit.
Is there a rule about how much you should prune, not prune?
The rule of thumb is do not remove more than one-third of the foliage, or what will be the foliage when it comes out, for most plants. And I'll, if I have time, show you a couple exceptions to that as well. Okay, so spring flowering plants, you want to wait until they bloom and then do their pruning. So do your rhododendron and azalea pruning after they finish blooming. they start to set their flower buds in mid-July. So between, you know, when they finish their bloom and mid-July is when you want to do your pruning on those if you don't want to interfere with the flower display. Again, if you don't care how many flowers you have next year, you can prune them anytime you want. It won't hurt the plant. It will just reduce the number of flowers. Okay. If you have plants like hydrangeas and roses that are summer flowering plants, so they're forming those, well, hydrangeas is another one like hibiscus. There's different types, and some form their flowers on new wood and some on old wood, so that's probably not a good example. But if you have summer flowering or late summer flowering plants, chances are they're forming their flower buds on new growth, and so you can do your pruning before they start growing in the spring. Okay, basic process of pruning. Okay, question? Winter. Most of our wooden plants are adapted to New Hampshire are going dormant. They've already received the shortening day length signal by mid-August, I would say. And so even if you prune, you know, late August, September, even though they be perfectly nice, you're not apt to stimulate new growth. Now there are a few exceptions to that. Anybody think of one offhand? I've had people tell me that they have stimulated late growth of lilacs by late pruning. Okay. But the worst case scenario is you may lose some of that new growth, but you're not. It's not going to affect the actual cold hardiness of the whole plant as a whole. Okay. That's not dependent on that. Another question?
I just wanted to mention improper pruning of different types of hydrangeas is the most frequently asked pruning problem question that comes into our garden center. So people are
Gail Kerrigan, dial extension 9275. Gail Kerrigan, extension 9275, please.
What time they have, so you cut it down, and it's never flowered, and the whole thing, so you've got to find it.
You've got to relate that back to which kind of hydrangea is it? Is it a... Well, maybe. Although the macrophylla, the big leaf hydrangea that we've traditionally said, you know, you're really chancing it if you're growing it here, that was one that formed its flower buds in the late summer. And so the flower buds weren't real hardy, and they'd often get killed over the winter. In fact, the plant would get killed back to the ground, and then it would send vegetative growth up. So they'd have lots of leaves, but no flowers, and people didn't like that.
There it is in a nutshell.
Okay, so that's it in a nutshell. But the paniculatas, the arborescens, they are late summer bloomers. They're forming their blooms on new wood, so you can dormant season prune them and they're still gonna flower just fine. And also we do now have endless summer and endless this and that. The other thing that will flower on new wood, and that's exactly what they're doing. They've selected those big leaf hydrangeas that form flowers on new wood, and so if you lose the bud over the winter, it will rebud for some wood. So that's a nice thing to have in a climate like ours.
Is there a reference for these different types of hydrangeas in the notebook that will be at the garden center?
No.
We have to make our own.
Yeah, it's really the difference between the macrophylla, which is the big leaf hydrangea, and the arborescens or paniculatas, which are the late summer ones. And then within that big leaf, you've got different varieties that are blooming at different times. So probably your garden center person's going to know. They probably chose those varieties for a certain reason, and maybe not. Yes.
When it comes to, say, loose roses, when they get to, I know typically you should, if you want them to keep their shape, you should take them down every single year. I know that. What if you've got a spruce or a blue spruce or whatever with a, you know, diamond type shape that all of a sudden you decide is too big, and how much can you take it down, or can you?
lot of things come into that. Let me skip through some slides, and I've got some slides towards the end on that. I'm going to skip kind of through a lot of these text slides. But keep in mind, when you're pruning shrubs, what you want is a mixture of stems of different ages. You don't want to prune out all your new growth every year and just leave the old stuff. You don't want to prune out all the old stuff every year and just have, you know, wimpy looking new stuff. So you want some old, some new. Eventually those old branches will die or get disease or something, and you'll cut them out. So you want to have branches of all age coming along. No meatballs. This is what we would like. Okay, this is funny because it's burning bush, back when it was okay to use. But this was the before picture. This is the after picture. See how they thinned it out, brought it back by removing entire branches rather than shearing it, which just is continuously cutting off the new growth. Okay, and what you end up when you have sheared plants is you've got a very thin layer on the outside that has leaves on it, and everything else inside is bare. And it's a pretty unhealthy situation for the plant, because of course the plant depends on the amount of photosynthesis is going on, which depends on the amount of leaf area you have to support the plant. So when you're pruning shrubs, you can either thin them, which means you're removing entire branches and so forth, back to a larger branch. Okay, this is a good way to control the size and density and still maintain multiple layers, some new, some old, and so forth, as opposed to heading. But with heading, instead of always, you know, cutting back to another branch and so forth, you're just making those kind of random cuts in there, and you will get a lot more stimulation of growth from inside of the plant. So instead of really redirecting the growth to existing branches, you're causing a lot of new branches to break, and you'll get a lot more growth occurring down inside the plant. If you've allowed it to get like this, then you can do some heading cuts and get some more denser foliage. Yes.
What do we tell our customers that are looking to do formal hedging? A lot of people do, especially in the city. We're over near Manchester,
yep.
So people want, you know, privet and use to make nice formal hedges. But they're always coming back saying the insides are dead, because they are.
Exactly.
Is there any way around that?
The only thing is to clip them frequently instead of letting them put a lot of growth on and then cutting quite a bit off at a time. Just cut a little bit off at a time. If you're, you know, an arborist at Kew Gardens in England, you're probably out there pruning these hedges every couple of weeks, and you're just taking a little bit off at a time. Okay. There are places for formal hedges like this. There's not an awful lot of places in New Hampshire where we need formal hedges like this. And so whenever possible, encourage people to go with a naturalistic form of the plant, work with it, unless they really enjoy pruning and want to make topiaries and shapes and everything like that. But whether it's a formal hedge or an informal hedge, one of the keys is to make the top narrower than the bottom, because that gives it more surface area exposed to sunlight, and you're more apt to keep some of the leaves on the bottom of the plant for longer. So that's the only thing really you could tell them. Otherwise, if you're, you know, letting the top, and this is the natural tendency, is to let the top get wider and wider and wider and cut more and more off the bottom, and you end up with this shape thing, and then you're shaded out all those bottom leaves, and you end up with bare stems. If you want to correct that at this point, here's a privet hedge that's been sheared over the years, and so it's got all this new growth up here, and this is all bare. You can make your thinning cuts back at various levels in that, and some heading cuts, and stimulate some new growth back from the bottoms of those plants. Even more drastic, there are some plants that will tolerate this coppicing, which is cutting everything back to 6 to 12 inches off the ground. And if your plant was good and healthy, and it's a vigorous plant, it will send a lot of new growth out. Your hedge may look funny for a year or two, but eventually it will look fine. But if your plant was not vigorous and healthy, you're apt to finish it off by doing this practice. So you'll either cure it or kill it, I guess, is the bottom line on that. Needle evergreens, and somebody had a question about spruce. These are not plants that we normally would prune every year. Best time to prune them would be after their growth flush in the spring. If you prune on needle evergreens in the fall, it's just going to add to the likelihood of getting some fall or winter burn, because you're exposing branches and leaves that weren't exposed to full sun, and now they are. And during that winter period, with the reflected sun from the snow and the frozen soil and everything, you're apt to burn them. The other thing that makes it complicated is there are some evergreens that will grow back if you cut into old wood, say wood that's older than 2, 3, 4 years old. But there are some, and spruce is in this group, as well as juniper and pine. If you cut back into old wood thinking that you're going to stimulate growth from there, it's just going to sit there and look like you've chopped its head off for a long, long time. Okay, so ideally, as you're pruning evergreens, you still want to maintain one central leader, just like you would on a deciduous tree. Okay, the key is to do this either gradually, if you've got a lot now, don't remove them all during 1 year, you're going to make the plant look really funny. But ideally, if people are training their plants from a young stage, they wouldn't allow several leaders to develop. You just want one trunk on a spruce, like our Christmas tree. You just want one central trunk, right? You don't want three tops on it. Okay, so don't allow those other ones to grow up. If you want to bring the size back to it, you need to kind of envision a perimeter line. Say, I want everything to be back within this line. It's getting out of bounds here. When we are cutting back, we're not going to just come and shear this unless we are growing a Christmas tree. But the best thing for the tree would be to, okay, prune not with shears but with hand pruners. Feel your way back along those branches until you get back within that perimeter line and you're finding where it's attached to another branch, and then cut it off there. Okay, that way you're going to be cutting different branches at different places. You're not going to make the tree look too different or funny when you're done, and it will redirect its growth and make it into a nice pyramid shape tree. And there's a before and after picture of doing that, and that's really pretty well described in that pruning evergreens fact sheet that you have. It's something that you really have to kind of think about. It's not a real natural feeling, at least for me, to prune an evergreen. And so you kind of have to think about what you're doing and really try to envision where that perimeter line is. Okay, broadleaf evergreens, I think I'll just kind of skip this, but if you've got old leggy stems, cut those big old stems back. Just don't take out more than a third of the stems or the growth each year. And so you don't have to let your rhododendron take over your window. So on this one, we might say, okay, this one's too big. Follow that back to where it intersects with a bigger stem and cut it right here. Okay. Follow this one back to where it intersects and cut it right there. So you're not really changing the form or the shape of the plant. You're just coming back with larger branches. You're not stimulating a lot of growth because you're not making cutting cuts.
I have a particular problem this year with my baby. I have very old rhododendrons that were planted years ago on the property. And this year, for the very first time, the deer had the old leaves open. Now, I want to know what kind of pruning should I do on something like that so that the plants don't die? They're big. I mean,
well, the deer have already done quite a bit of pruning
before you.
So they've already removed a certain amount. You can come in and kind of shape it. I would again do the selective branch pruning rather than shearing or cutting the whole thing back. I think you'll probably kill it at this point if you cut it all back. It may not look great this year, and you may need to cut some more off next year.
It would be better to prune it some in the spring
so that it doesn't have so much stem to support, you know what I mean?
In other words, you have long stems with no side branches.
Oh, yeah, I mean, the stems on this thing are like this big. I mean, we bought the house a few years ago.
Yeah, and that's probably a case where you want to take a certain number of those, cut them back pretty far, and stimulate some side branches to grow, and then next year select, you know, a few of those instead of having 25 branches all growing from that cut. Select a few to encourage to grow up in. Rachel, how are we doing on time? And is Margaret here? Okay. Well, let's take a break, and if Margaret's not here at 2:30, I'll keep talking.
Before they leave, a copy of that Master Gardener contract and the medical